Tonight's video is accompanied by Nonsuch Brewing's Baltic Porter. The tasting notes in the can suggest that it is a smooth coffee and chocolate notes. This Nonsuch Brewing does some pretty good beers, and the name itself is a reference to local history. I've talked about that before, and I'll put a link down in the description because I think it's a really interesting thing where they got the name from. So, as you can see, I have been doing some tinkering and experimenting and working on a project which, as you can also see, is somewhat unfinished. Well, okay, completely unfinished. But it sort of works, not the way I intended it to, and it's not in its final form yet, but here we go. I just figured since this thing has been taking me just like spare time in my evenings, which I haven't had much of, just like an hour here, an hour there, for probably 3 weeks to a month. And the fun part has been, you know, soldering this all up and getting it working. For me personally, the less fun part has been bashing my head against the software and the whatnot. I know a lot of guys that are coming to Arduino are coming to it from a software first standpoint. They understand software, they can write code, and the hardware is the new thing. For me, it's exactly the opposite. I've been doing hardware since forever. I mean, professionally for 35 years, tinkering with hardware. But I haven't really done coding at all since high school. And that was, you know, that was Commodore PET Basic. And until I bought an Arduino starter kit a few years ago, I literally hadn't touched code. So this is basically starting from scratch for me. And the good thing about the Arduino platform is all the libraries and the example code that comes with them that lets you get up to speed with things pretty quickly and lets you get fairly quickly to the point where you can have a project that mostly does what you want, you know? So this, in case you don't recognize it or don't remember it, is a DMX 512 controlled, cheapest available on eBay, stage light. It communicates, as I said, with using the DMX 512 protocol, which is a professional lighting protocol. And in a previous mailbag, I got this sort of USB adapter. This one being a cheap, crappy one, doesn't use the standard connector. The standard connector is a 5-pin XLR. This one and a lot of other cheap ones use a 3-pin. Whatever, that aside, it does the job. It speaks the protocol, which is the important thing. And it lets me tinker with this. So what I have been working towards is just like a small lighting console, essentially. I've got 6 linear faders here that I got in a mailbag a month or so ago. Hiding down in here is a little Max 485 chip, which is a RS-485 line driver. It is taking its control from this Arduino Nano over here. The 6 pots are going into 6 of the 8 available analog inputs over here. The other 2 analog inputs are doubling as I2C, which is controlling this LCD display. Yeah, liquid crystal display. And other things that I have soldered together on here, I've got a rotary encoder, which is not doing what I want it to do. It's a software problem. It is supposed to, in my head, I wanted it to select what channel these pots are starting at. Okay, back up a little bit. DMX 512 has, as the name would suggest, 512 channels of control. This light here uses 8 of them. I've only got 6 pots on here because that's how many analog inputs I have available. But basically, one controls each, the brightness of each of the colors, red, green, blue, and white. This one is a master, just dims the whole thing at once. This one is a chasing mode or a strobing mode, a flashing mode, and you adjust it adjusts the speed of that flashing. And the other 2 on this light are sound control or fade, auto fade, and channel 8 would be the speed control for channel 7. On the light and on every light, you can tell it what its starting address is. So of those eight channels, we're starting channel one is actually channel one. If I was to set this thing to start at channel 10, then the first channel of it would be 10, the second one would be 11, the third one would be 12, and so on. What I'm hoping to do, or what I was intending to do with this rotary encoder, is to select that base channel so that I could program the light to start with, I don't know, channel 10. So then this first pot would be channel 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. And that's all well and good, except I've run into some problems in library incompatibilities, which is the downside of using Arduino libraries. It hides all the ugly gubbins from the beginners, which is a good thing, but it also hides what's going on from the beginners. So it makes it a lot more difficult to figure out what's going wrong when you've got two libraries trying to use the same resource and just barfing at you. Earlier on in my experiments, I was using this little OLED to display the channel number. Unfortunately, the Adafruit supplied library for this thing, which is the most common library and the one almost every tutorial uses, is not compatible with or interferes with the DMX library, which, again, there's a couple of libraries that can be used with this and a couple of libraries that can be used with the DMX, and I've played with them a little bit and I've picked the ones that are most commonly used, so they have the most tutorials and whatnot, and they just don't want to, I couldn't get any of them to coexist, actually, and some of them just flat didn't work for reasons that escaped me. At one point, I was going to try and use the CD4511 LED drivers with a handful of 7-segment LEDs, but I discovered that I've only got a couple of common cathode 7-segment LEDs. I've got a bunch of common anodes. And this guy prefers to work with common cathode. And like I said, I would have had to order some more LEDs. So that went by the by. I tried a couple other things and then finally settled on using this LCD, which maybe I will mount it up there. Or maybe I'll put it over there and just eat the fact that this thing's going to be huge. It also allowed me a little bit more screen real estate. So I have the channel and then I have the 6 potentiometer readouts showing on there. So I can tell what I'm doing, which seems to be an even better idea than my first idea. So the project evolves. So I guess kind of a point of me doing this video is just to show, I guess, that the no matter how much experience with the hardware you've got, or the software or whatever, there's always stuff to learn. You're always going to run into pitfalls and stuff. And like I said, with my work, I haven't been having enough time to just spend like hours and hours on this. It's just like I said, half an hour here, an hour there in the evenings in between shifts and whatnot. But I think this is going in the general direction that I wanted it to go. So there's a few other things that I'd like to do with this beast, but I'm going to need some parts. I think I'm going to abandon the rotary encoder. I think I am going to stick with this display. The nano, like I said, is going to go on the board, although with that out of the way, it might fit in a different spot. And I think, well, I've ordered a bunch of dip switches, which might seem a little bit old school, and it is. And a lot of the early DMX lights, were their address was programmed using dip switches on the back of them. I guess, yeah, how often do you change that? For a traveling show, it stays the same throughout the entire run of the show. For a bar install, it stays there forever. For a band that's on the road playing bar gigs and whatnot, it might change now and again, but probably not. The only time you really change it on a frequent basis is if it's in a rental system, so why not? And this circuit board that I'm using, it's some that I got a long time ago in a mailbag, just from a cheap seller on eBay. But it's kind of interesting. It's not Vero board. It's not straight up perf board. Let me get in a little closer. It sort of emulates the track layout on a breadboard. We have what, 4 pins tied together there, and then we have voltage buses. In this case, I've just designated them positive and negative. And so each vertical strip of pair of power buses has a positive and a negative in it. It's interesting. It's a, maybe more versatile than Vero board, maybe a little bit less versatile, but also less soldering than using perf board. I don't know. I think I like it. It's, I don't know, this is my first time using it. I bought three or four pieces of it back when I originally bought it, and it seems to be doing the job. So I am slowly going through using various bits and pieces that I've accumulated over the years. And that's a big part of how I do things, is just order stuff that you think you might need that might be handy. And then when a project comes to mind, you've got it all in stock to use it. Again, I had like three different display technologies that I tinkered with until I settled on this one. The RS-485 chips, I bought a whole whack of them because they were cheap and they seemed like something that would come in handy. I've had the rotor encoders for probably 3 or 4 years. You know, it's not for everybody, but it's how I do things, and it seems to work out for me. Speaking of which, and because it's a short video, I think I'm just going to set this thing up with some software and play with that with the light a little bit. And if you've got a computer or a tablet that's got USB out on it, you don't need the hardware to control it. Here you can just control it all from your computer. And that's how a lot of modern lighting desks work. They're essentially just a computer with a custom hardware user interface with, you know, faders and knobs and buttons and whatnot, but all just being controlled by software. So the software in question, the freely available one that I grabbed that's compatible with Linux and, you know, all your other popular computer platforms, it's called Q-Lite Controller Plus. And it seems to be fairly well recommended, especially for beginners just starting out. So let's start with the inputs and outputs menu. Now I've already got my USB device plugged in and it's recognized here and it's already selected as an output, so that's good. You can do all kinds of different output devices, or you can even use ArtNet, which operates over a TCP/IP network if you want to. Now then, let's define us a fixture, which is what devices are called. Now I could just go with a generic one, starts at address 1, tell it that it has 8 channels, because we saw that in the manual earlier. Boom, there we go. Remember I was talking about dip switches? Well, if there was a dip switch to select the channel on the back of this thing, there is how you'd set it. Very handy. You can define different parameters for your light. I'm not going to do that. But now we'll just go over to a simple lighting desk here. And start and bring up the main. Remember that first one is the main brightness. Then the second one is red, third one is green, blue, and the fourth one is white. So there's, they're all at max. So this is laid out basically like a traditional lighting console would be. And then what do we have here? Oh yeah, that's the strobing. Right, there you go. That is different automatic modes. And then that one is, and then 8 is the speed of those automatic modes. But again, I'm not going to use those ones. I don't think they're all that useful for what I'm intending. And actually, I don't really need anything past 6. But you have to program it to expect all 8 of them. Otherwise, if you only said, I only need the first 5, and then you programmed another light to start at 6, when you operated that light's first channel, it would also operate this one. And then the other thing that we can do is we can set up different submasters here, different scenes. So right now I've got everything on at full. I'll pull that one up and I will record that cue onto number 1. Let's shut all these guys off here. And now I can control them all together with that one cue. Or I can bump or flash them just by tapping that. So then I could set up something else, put it on there, record that as cue number 2. Okay, so then if I go into cue playback mode, I can just bump between the cues. So then if you had a lot of lights, you could set up scenes, basically, or cues, they're calling it here, for each one, and just bump between them so you don't have to, during your performance, fly around on these faders up here, which is kind of neat. And again, most traditional lighting boards had something similar to that. Now, there's a lot of other stuff going on in here. They're talking about the concept of universes. So remember I said there's 512 channels available, but what happens if you run out of channels? Well, then you create a second universe. You assign that second universe to a different output device, and then you've got another 512 channels in that universe, and third and fourth and whatnot. Where that comes in handy is when you've got a lot of fixtures that use a lot of channels. So add another fixture, and we'll just see what we can find here. Well, let's go for the granddaddy of all moving fixtures, the very light. It has 31 channels in that one light alone. You could see if you had a bunch of those in your rig, you'd use up your 512 channels right quick in a hurry. So I'm going to edit my light here just to put it up somewhere out of the way so I can define another one. Let's define this stage right 10 watt by 9 LED flat par. I've just discovered wandering through here, it has basically the same layout as my light, but when you look at it on the simple desk, it has custom icons, which are pretty cool. So there is the master, which doesn't do anything until you bring up a color. There's the red, the green, the blue, and the white. That is the strobing mode, as we saw before. That is the just sort of randomly wander through different colors at its own pace mode, and there is the speed for that. So that's essentially the same, but it's got custom icons. And I assume when you're defining your own, you can probably customize the icons. I haven't found that yet, but it seems like a pretty obvious thing you should be able to do. But that is just a basic tour of this little piece of software for talking to the DMX lights. And for a small band, and you just set up a laptop with this, you would be sailing. Maybe set up some kind of a button box to control it, or a foot switch or something like that, just to bump between from one scene to another, from one of the cues to another. Anyway, I'm not sure if there's a huge point to this video today, other than just to show what I've been tinkering with, and I guess remind especially beginners not to give up if your project doesn't go the way you want it. You pivot, you try something different, you tinker with it, you get to a frustration point, you order more parts, you wait 2 months for them to show up, and you carry on, which is what I'm going to do with this thing. I can't promise it'll show up again, although I'd kind of like it to. But yeah, this one I am using in large part as a software learning platform for myself, which, as I've said many times, I suck at. So, like I even said at the beginning, you're probably getting tired of hearing it. But you don't get better unless you play with it and practice, right? So that's where this is going. And at some point, I would like to basically build one of these from scratch. I don't know when I'm going to do it. I don't know how successful I'm going to be, but it's worth a challenge. And that way then I've got the computer and I can control both of them at once, or I can use this thing. Did I need something like this? No, absolutely not. This is a learning platform. There are commercial devices, little handheld boxes made specifically for testing lights in the field. Might have been handy for me to have, a few years ago when I was helping a buddy out doing band lighting, but I don't do that anymore. So this is just a toy to play with and learn from, which is, like I said, that's the important part here. Anyway, thanks for watching. Questions and comments down below. I'll talk to you later.